Thank you for coming out, everybody. Olivia Collette, who came all the way from Canada, and boy are her arms tired, and arrived with suitcases, a heroic effort. Olivia wrote the analysis of Alexandre Desplat's score for the Grand Budapest Hotel, which you can find in the new book. It's really a wonderful section of the book. She's a classical musician, and she supplied me with the knowledge that she gleaned, and I used it to make myself not sound stupid when talking to people like Randall. Based in Montreal, Olivia has written for various print and online publications, including the Montreal Gazette, RogerEbert.com, World Film Location, San Francisco, IndieWire's Press Play blog, and many, many others. And watch out, she'll probably drag you to karaoke. Randall Poster, our guest of honor, is, well, you're here for Randall. Randall's first credit as music supervisor was, I think, on Larry Clark and Harmony Crane's film Kids, is that right?
That's right.
Okay. And since then, he has been a music supervisor on, I believe, over 100 films and television programs, including The Crossing Guard, I Shot Andy Warhol, Velvet Goldmine, The Thomas Crown Affair, Boys Don't Cry, Zoolander, Little Black Book, The Squid and the Whale. This is basically every soundtrack you own. The Aviator, Zodiac, I'm Not There, Gentlemen Broncos, Spring Breakers, and The Wolf of Wall Street, not to mention HBO's Mildred Pierce and Boardwalk Empire, and A Season of Lost. But some of his most fruitful collaborations have been so long-lived that they could be subjects of their own books, notably Richard Linklater, for whom he helped choose or secure multiple music multiple times, including on School of Rock and Boyhood. And last but certainly not least, he's worked with Wes Anderson, the subject of two books by yours truly, Bottle Rocket, Rushmore, Royal Tenenbaums, Life Aquatic, Darjeeling Limited, and its accompanying short film, Hotel Chevalier, Fantastic Mr. Fox, Moonrise Kingdom, and of course that fine film, Whose Yodeling Introduced Us. So I think we should start by talking about the Grand Budapest Hotel. Do we have audio? Great.
Testing.
Okay.
Great.
Fantastic. Now, this is a very multi-layered, complicated soundtrack, right? You've got a very strong symphonic element that's interacting very actively with the action, and then you also have these songs, which, is it right to call them period? It's a fictional Europe.
Yeah. You know, I think that they may not all be period recordings, you know, but they are certainly period compositions, or they're, you know, they would have lived in the period. Mm-hmm. There are a couple of sort of folk tunes that probably, you know, ascend from the centuries.
And what did what sorts of conversations did Wes have with you about the tone of these songs or the vision of them? Or,
well, you know, I think that we probably have more music that plays in this film than in any of other films that we did together. And I think that we probably had, we went into the process of sort of developing our musical ideas for the film with sort of less of an established foundation than we have before. I mean, Wes and I are neither experts in classical music, and really, I guess it was sort of my first task was to sort of gather some elements and sounds for consideration. And so, you know, we went, I gathered the great classical composers of each of these countries that might have surrounded Zbrojka. And then we went and I searched for all the various folk music, whether it was, you know, French military marches or Weimar cabaret or English dance hall. And we just sort of went through sort of a panoply of sounds and really then sort of landed on the balalaika as sort of a key sound for the film. You know, and as Wes has said, and will say, was some of the history that our story lives within sort of took shape sort of later in the pre-production process, where I think Wes has talked about in terms of the sort of the fascist element, how that sort of kind of emerged, the time definitions became more apparent to us as we got closer to shooting the film. And going into it, it was a little bit less clear, so it sort of led my journey to was pretty far reaching in terms of trying to find music that would be appropriate for us.
I actually have a question. You talked about far-reaching, and I understand in the book, Wes mentions that, you know, when you need to find somebody who plays a really rare instrument, you know, from Hungary or something, you send Randy. So one of the instruments in particular was the cymbalum, and I believe Jenny Linkan is one of the people that you... How do you find someone like Jenny Linkan, and where did you find him?
We just sort of started to gather cymbalum recordings and try to find cymbalum players, and then we found Jenny Linkan, and he really is a gypsy who lives in Holland and who drove to our recording session in London. And it was interesting too, because we really have sort of twin cymbalum players. We had a sort of a more trained English film orchestra cymbalum player who played a lot of the more metric moments in the score. And then where Jenny Linkan was sort of like the Jimi Hendrix of the cymbalum and sort of let him roam. And actually they would play together and played separately. And so that was really kind of a unique combination of the tamed and studied cymbalum as well as then the sort of the wild gypsy sound. And I think that, you know, Wes is very obviously very specific and very decisive. And so when he and we commit to trying something, we really go all the way. You know, which in this film had us bringing, you know, Russian balalaika players to France to play with a French group, and we had two translators on the podium with the conductor, and we both feel, I think, that that's where sort of magic happens, when you sort of create these moments for rare combination. And Wes is, you know, another key element in this film score is the alpine horn, which is this, you know, it's a horn that basically would go from here to that pole, and it can basically play like three notes. And, you know, the musical arranger's like, well, I don't know that you really want alpine horns, maybe we can get what you're looking for. Or the French horn, something, we're like, no, we want alpine horns. How many can you get? and I don't think you'd ever had like more, like I don't think three alpine horn players like had been in the same room ever. Because really that's an instrument that basically, in reality, like the alpine, from town to town, that's how they would sort of communicate in like a Morse code type thing.
How do you bring an alpine horn from one place to another?
Yeah, by van, I think. But it's a beautiful instrument, and really hand-painted, and so this was sort of the orchestra that we created. And it's interesting too, is that balalaika, you know, again, we had advice where people said, well, if you have balalaika, maybe you want some mandolins to give it a little bit of a round out the sound and give it some bottom end and have some flexibility, because balalaika is also, they become untuned very, very readily. And no, we just want the balalaika. And I think that, you know, I mean, I think it was revealed the benefit of that in the just sort of beautiful music that was made to work with the film.
There was a comment Alexandre made about the instrumentation where he said that he wanted the soundtrack to not be too big or too clean, and that the phrase he used was he wanted it to have mud beneath its shoes. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about that idea?
You know, Alexandre's English is a bit challenging, so I don't know if that's where you're going. You know, I think it's to the inspiration of Wes that really he doesn't want anything to feel too practiced or too studied, and have to show the spirit of inspiration, and I think the naivete of some of the playing and some of the combinations. You know, again, in the film too, is that there's a we use recorders, you know, and people say, oh, well, you know, you really do want to have some flutes or a clarinet in there. And no, we didn't do it that way. And I think that, you know, Wes is always never inclined to do something because that's the way people say that you do it. And he will live with those decisions.
He gave me many examples of that, including the choice of using real animal hair on the animals in The Fantastic Mr. Fox. And he specifically said that the animators told him, you really shouldn't do that because you'll see the fingerprints on the left by the animators. And he said, that's exactly why I want real animal hair.
Yeah.
I believe there wasn't even a conventional string section in the parts where there was a full orchestra playing.
Yeah, there was really nothing conventional, really, about it. We didn't, you know, I mean, even to the point where, you know, we have a church organ that plays, and it was our decision, really, rather than hiring, you know, the best organist in London, and they're maybe the greatest in the world that we could have selected, is that Wes really wanted to have, you know, the guy who played the church organ that we were using, you know. and I mean, again, that makes it really fun to do, and maybe a bit, you know, there's a bit of nail biting that maybe goes on, or a bit of, you know, it sort of falls on me to sort of make the people who would want to object or propose an alternate methodology, you know, it's up to me to sort of tell them to zip it, really.
And you really got the right organ player. I mean, that section on the mountaintop, there's a point where it sounds, he really starts to cook, and it's like he's going to bust into Inagata De Vita.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really intense.
Yeah.
The idea of a modular score is something that Wes had talked about, this idea of building out a score in sections rather than recording an orchestra all at once.
Right.
Where did that come from, and why is that important?
Well, I think that it just gives Wes more flexibility to work with it, you know, and I think that's really the reason why we work in that way, you know, that he wants to be able to assemble and dissemble as he sees fit.
Mm-hmm.
And so much of the creation of the score happens in when we record the music, or even in terms of how we land on some of the thematics, is that Wes works with music editorial to sort of construct the pieces and then sends them back to Desplat to then, you know, orchestrate it to smooth them out or to add something more.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think it just gives Wes more options to and more flexibility.
Can we talk a little bit about the idea of choosing the right song, and maybe a little bit sort of backing up about what a music supervisor does? Because I think there's a perception among a lot of people, and I used to be one of these people, that the music supervisor was the person who picks the songs, and basically if you have great taste, you can do it. There's a lot more involved, clearly, right?
Well, you know, I mean, I describe it as, especially with the, you know, I've been really lucky in working with some brilliant filmmakers over a long period of time. Todd Haynes and I went to school together. Todd Phillips and I have done 8 movies together. Richard Linklater and I have done 5 or 6 movies together, and Wes and I now have done 8 movies together. A lot of the work that we do is just sort of, I describe my role as the person who the director has to talk to about the music. And largely a lot of the success or a lot of the specifics that are borne out in the filmmaking come from the back and forth that happens between the movies oftentimes. And so I will never be the person that says, like, you know, people say, oh, you're the person who picks the songs in the Wes Anderson movies, and I would never say that, because really, the director picks the songs, really, and I am the person who helps them to maybe devise and execute the musical strategy for the film. And it's really just part of an ongoing conversation that is also rooted in whether or not it's set in period, or we have to have musicians playing on camera, or whatever the story might dictate my having to step it up one way or another before we start shooting the movie.
Mm-hmm.
At the beginning of the movie, the yodeling that we heard just a few moments ago, and at the beginning of the movie, that actually comes from another movie, right?
Well, Almost. So, you know, when we were again sorting through the different folk sounds and trying to find some specifics, you know, Wes showed me a film by Werner Herzog called Heart of Glass that had this yodeling in it. And it's a specific kind of yodeling. It's called Zowerly, which is sort of geographically centered. There was no soundtrack album for this record. There was no movie soundtrack that included this piece of music. And I searched high and wide for some more information about it. You could Shazam it to no good effect. and then finally, you know, basically I went and got in touch with Werner Herzog's people, and we got the, you know, they sent us a DAT of the music, and yet it was seemed to me unclear what rights they had actually acquired and where what kind of legal chain of title would be available to us. And so, in spite of the fact that we had this thing, and then actually we found another piece of music that Wes preferred, because otherwise if he did not prefer it, I would have been in wherever I would have been trying to get that cleared up for both the Herzog people and
you're knocking on Herzog's door in the middle of the night.
So we did all that. I mean, you know, it's really, it's been a wonderful life in this. Quest. I mean, it has taken me around the world. You know, we did Darjeeling Limited, and it was this notion that we were going to use the film music of Satyajit Ray and related pieces. I mean, I was in Calcutta in Satyajit Ray's house, convincing them to let me have these recordings because you couldn't just go to Tower Records and sort of buy them all And so it's really quite an adventure to sort of gather all this stuff and then figure out a way to use it, you know, righteously.
I want to move over a little bit to talk about existing pop songs. And the clip that we're going to show now is from the Royal Tenenbaums, which I assume at least some of you here have seen. And maybe we can talk about that soundtrack and some others and sort of the challenges that are involved in choosing a song, placing the song, and making sure that you can use it. Oh, yeah. Can we do that? Lights, please.
What are you doing in my tent?
Just listening to some records. Aren't you supposed to be in the hospital?
Check myself out.
How many stitches did you get?
I don't know. You want to see?
Jesus. Reggie, that looks horrible.
I heard about your ex-husband.
Desmond?
I guess so. I didn't get his name.
Yeah. I met him in the ocean. I was swimming and he came out to me in a canoe. We were only married 9 days.
And I heard about Eli.
No. Poor Eli. Anyway, we mostly just talked about you.
You did?
Yeah. I guess that was the attraction, if you know what I mean.
I have to tell you something.
What's that?
I love you.
I love you too.
can't stop thinking about you. I went away for a year and it only got worse and I don't know what to do.
Let's lie down for a minute. This is the sleeping bag we took to the museum, isn't it? Why'd you do it? Because of me?
Yeah, but it's not your fault.
You're not gonna do it again, are you?
I doubt it.
She would never say where she came from. Yesterday don't matter if it's gone. While the sun is bright, or in the darkest night, no one knows.
I think we're just gonna have to be secretly in love with each other and leave it at that, Richie.
So a couple of questions about that. Lights again, I guess. You've got Rolling Stones, who are, for better or worse, had been, until Wes came along, associated very strongly with Martin Scorsese. And you've also got two songs that I think are from the same album, but they're not actually on the same
right.
side of the record.
Right.
Can you talk about the entire Stones connection with Wes and that scene? And
well, you know, we worked very hard to get the rights to use the Rolling Stones in the movie. It was owned, the records were owned by a record company called Abco. And Abco was started by a guy named Alan Klein, who was still alive when we made the movie. He's since passed. And as you'll see, we released the last, I think, three or four soundtracks on Abco. And I think that, you know, we have managed to, you know, we've used the Rolling Stones quite a bit. You know, as far as what I love about that, and I haven't seen it in a little bit, is just I love watching a song, you know, a scene where the song goes to the next record, the next song on the record, and, you know, there will be the train spotters who will say, well, that's not the running order of the record, but, you know, I leave their lives to them. So I don't know. I mean, it's pretty great. And again, I think what I remember in the moment, I think what we were talking about the second song, what I really admired about Wes was how, I mean, Ruby Tuesday is probably one of the most popular or obvious Rolling Stone songs in it. Like, there's no hesitation to sort of like worry about. There is no hesitation to think about what anybody else is really going to think.
Right.
And that's how we do it.
When I saw a preview of the Royal Tenenbaums at the New York Film Festival in 2001, Wes introduced it and he cautioned that the music was not final. And I don't know if you were there for that, but
I was there.
It was Hey Jude, it was the Beatles version of Hey Jude that played in that
right.
cut, and that was not what ended up in the movie.
Right.
Can you talk about that story?
I mean, I guess I'll talk about that story. You know, let's just say, first I'll say that I don't think either of us would feel like we, at the end of the day, that the movie was diminished by where we ultimately landed. And the Beatles have been impossible. Up to that point, had really not been licensing any of their music at all for films. And I think it had been something like 20 years before they would license a song. we went and we showed the movie to Paul McCartney, and we had had a good relationship with Yoko Ono. We used O Yoko in Rushmore. And unfortunately, we were navigating it, and then really unfortunately, George Harrison got sick, and it just was not going to resolve. So we had to make other plans. And I think that again, that I think that the Mark Mothersbaugh's version of Hey Jude really served the movie in a great and elegant way. And I would say this, and I've said this before, is that the Beatles are so fraught with people's associations that I always felt like it's sort of like kryptonite. Like it's just so overwhelmingly powerful and disassociative that I just felt like we ended up in a better place.
What's it like to watch a Wes Anderson movie where the music's not finished? I mean, it's such a strong part of the personality of the movie.
Well, I mean, it was all very well done, and it was really, I mean, the impact of it, I think, was... the movie was rendered with the same emotional impact. I think that it was much to the chagrin of Disney's legal team that we were using music that we just were not going to make a wholesale switch, because we really did take it to the end of the line with the Harrison people and had tremendous support, but it just was not going to happen.
Is it typical to watch a Wes Anderson movie with what they call a temp track of songs? I mean, songs that maybe are sort of in the ballpark of what you might use, or do you go in with more or less a semi-finished idea of what the music is going to be, or does it depend?
I think that sometimes we look at it with intermediate versions of score pieces, really. And sometimes there'll be places where we maybe there are places where we don't have music, where ultimately we decide to put a piece of music. We don't really go through a very arduous testing process. So we look at the movie really ourselves and sort of at various stages to sort of see where we're at or see the movie from start to finish will reveal, and then we just work on it.
Can you give me an example of a place of a film where maybe you realized we shouldn't have a song there at all, and up to that point you've had it in your mind that there would be one?
I think maybe if we look at like Moonrise Kingdom, that there were points where we watched it sort of without some of the military marching and stuff like that, or the drum group, and so we expanded that, I think that just sort of is one that comes to mind. I think I would say with Budapest Hotel, we were on the road to it. For the most part, I think that, say, for Rushmore or Tenenbaums, those movies we really had a lot chosen before we even started shooting the movie.
Let's talk about a different movie. This is from somewhat earlier in the timeline. Lights, Please. This is Jesus's Son, which is a really wonderful film from, is it 98, I think? Yeah. You suggested this one. This is a great example of the right, what I call just the right song for a scene, and it's one that I think maybe a lot of people weren't familiar with unless they had vintage record collections. But let's play it. Oh no.
I got it.
All right.
Won't you be my girl? I went to
a dance just the other night. I saw a girl there, she was out of sight. I asked a friend of mine who she could be. He said that her friend just like called her Sweet Pea. Oh, Sweet Pea, come on, dance with me. Come on, come on, come on, and dance with me. Oh, Sweet Pea, won't you be my girl? Won't you, be my girl? I walked on over and I asked her to dance, thinking maybe later on we'll make a romance. But every guy there was thinking like me. I had to stand in line to get a...
Michelle. Did you get in the car? McInnes? Fuckhead. I was carrying a gun. Well, I never would have used it. It was so cheap, I was sure it would explode in my hands if I ever pulled the trigger, so it could only add to my humiliation. Hey, where's McInnes?
How the hell should I know? What's wrong? What? Did you get in the car?
McInnes. Fuckhead. I was carrying a gun. Well, I never would have used it. It was so cheap, I was sure it would explode in my hands if I ever pulled the trigger, so it could only add to my humiliation. Hey, where's McInnes?
How the hell should I know? What's wrong? Come on.
Go, go, go.
Hey, man,
lose him.
Get off my car.
Go, lose him.
Oh. Do you think he's all right?
Yeah. He's fine. He's just going to go back to the party. Don't worry about it.
It's McInnes I'm worried about.
McInnes?
Hey, caught me kissing Michelle.
Which one was Michelle?
You're really fond of that song, aren't you?
Yeah. That's a movie that I think that a lot of people haven't seen that I really love and really love working on. And just in terms of that piece of music, that was a movie that I got involved with later in the process of making. They were making the movie, and sort of in talking to Alison McLean, the director, I think originally they were using "I'm Dancing Barefoot" by Patti Smith in that scene, and I just felt like, you know, I think if we use music of the pop music and bubblegum of the '60s, I think it'll make this just all the more disturbing, I think it did.
So is that a case where you have a scene that's pretty much set and you have to find a song that matches the tempo of the dancing?
Yeah, if you watch if you took a video of yourself dancing to a song, you would see that the tempo, matching the tempo, is not really necessarily always
especially if it was me.
That movie, it really unfolded, the musical element really unfolded very naturally once we sort of made that commitment to Sweet Pea. And also I'll just say that the editor who came on as I did was an incredible editor named Geraldine Peroni, who had worked a lot with Robert Altman, and unfortunately is no longer with us here, but that's a movie that's very dear to me.
Olivia was talking to me about where music stops and how long it plays and the decision when to stop a song, and whether to do a hard cut, which is what we see in this scene, which creates a comic effect, or whether to fade it. You put it better than I did, but that idea of the timing and what it does emotionally.
Yeah, I mean, as it relates to Grand Budapest anyway, I noticed that a lot of the times for a scene that Monsieur Gustave is in, the music will stop abruptly. For him especially, it kind of leaves you hanging, because you know that the piece is supposed to resolve and it doesn't, and so you're left hanging, and then at some point in the movie he's literally left hanging.
Yeah.
And then eventually you find out near the end of the film that his life is cut short, and so maybe the music was foreshadowing that. So that was something that I certainly read into.
I think sometimes it's just sort of, you know, in the case of Grand Budapest Hotel, I think that some of the, I think it's really, that it's instinct really, in terms of when to stop and where to come in. I think obviously some of the stopping leads to, it's for comic effect at a certain point. I think if you look at that clip, you know, I think to me, one of the most interesting moments is like when it sort of modulates the song. It kind of goes on longer than you're comfortable with the song, and I think that's where it's almost like, by virtue of letting it go,
you're like, when is it going to stop?
Like settling the audience, and I think that was.
And he's pinned to the chair, and he doesn't know what to do.
Yeah. So it's.
And you kind of feel their discomfort as well, right? Because they're sort of okay with it.
When he showed me the clip, and in my memory, I forgot what came in between, but. You know, I just love that bit where the guy, where he says, "Guy, which one was Michelle?"
Well, it's funny because watching that clip, I was still hearing that song in my head, even though the song wasn't playing anymore.
Yeah.
Incidental byproduct or by design?
No, I think that. That's great. You only hope for that kind of response.
Well, I want to talk a little bit more about instrumentation and this idea of music that is created for a film that has to be in character in various ways. And the clip that we have here is from The Wolf of Wall Street. We'll just see what it is and then we'll talk about it. Now that's a case where I'm wondering, is that a recording? Is that musicians playing? What is that?
Well, I'll say that was really one of the most fun days I ever spent on a movie set. That was the Temple University Marching Band. And we pre-recorded them actually on site. So we have sort of the room. We really weren't going to get them to go into a recording studio, so we had a moment where there was quiet on the set, and we pre-recorded them there.
Hmm.
And there again was just, it was such a incredibly synchronized episode, with the twirlers and the strippers and the waiters, and it was really.
You make it sound like it's basically a musical number.
Yeah, it was. It was really incredibly well choreographed. And, of course, you mentioned Scorsese in reference to the Rolling Stones. I mean, Marty is the master of music, and we all learn from him and steal from him. And, I've been lucky enough to get to work with him. So, and he really is the most. Again, the most sort of committed to having the music carry you.
How do you find a marching band? I mean, why those guys instead of some other guys?
I'm trying to remember why it was that we ended up with Temple. I really don't remember exactly how we ended up with Temple.
When you're casting musicians for a scene like that, you're casting them, right? I mean, you're trying to get a particular sound or a particular look or something.
We had to find a marching band that had repertoire and also that were willing to sort of parade around in their underwear. So
I guess they were able to do that.
So your choices were unlimited.
Yeah. I don't remember why. It wouldn't surprise me if that wasn't in fact that. I don't remember actually how we landed on Temple.
That's okay.
Well, I want to talk about another example of creating music, and this one is far more, I guess, conceptually complex, and that is Velvet Goldmine. And you and I were talking about this a little bit beforehand, but. Was it originally going to actually, you were trying to use actual David Bowie music in it? What was the story?
Tom had written a script really built around existing David Bowie songs. And then, maybe like 3 or 4 weeks out of shooting, we got word back that we weren't going to get permission to use the songs that David Bowie had been planning his own Ziggy Stardust movie or play or whatever it was, and it just wasn't going to happen. And really, I thought it was a great opportunity because I felt very strongly that if we were able to do something original to the film, it would take on a life of its own and not just simply be a sort of a David Bowie pastiche. And so, very quickly, there was two guys, Nathan Marson and Craig Wedren, who were both in a band called Shudder to Think, handed me a cassette with these songs. That one was Hot One and one was Ballad of Maxwell Demon. And just on first listening, I just knew, like, we're gonna be good.
Well, let's listen to Hot One then.
First thing I wanted to ask about, because I understand, I actually really liked Velvet Goldmine, and the music was particularly notable. The first thing that comes to mind is, I mean, you could tell just from the sound that it's supposed to sound like Bowie. So how do you reproduce a Bowie-like sound?
Well, I mean, I think it's the construction of the song, you know, and I think the vocal, it feels more to me, it feels like it's born out of that glam rock era, really. That song just has like a great hook, and you know, it's one of those things where you get the benefit of, somehow you hear it for the first time and you feel like you've heard it before. And I think that is sort of one of the gifts of a great pop song, is that somehow you hear it for the first time, and by the time it goes into the chorus reprise, you're kind of singing along with it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's just sort of the magic of music, and I think that's what happened here. And again, I just think that it made the movie much more its own thing, rather than sort of being completely like, well, it's a David Bowie retread.
And I understand that the musicians on the Brian Slade team were English, and the musicians on the Kurt Wilde team were American?
Yes. I mean, there was some cross currency. The Kurt Wilde stuff we did with, we had a group, we called ourselves the Wild Rats, which we built on some of the Sonic Youth, Lee Ronaldo and Steve Shelley, Don Fleming, and Mark Arm sort of was the voice of Kurt. And then it's interesting is that with the Brian Slade stuff, is that vocally there were like five different singers who sang were the voices, and Tom York from Radiohead, Grantley Phillips from Grantley Buffalo, who's an American, who was one of the singers, and then Jonathan sang, and so, and nobody ever, you know, nobody ever really had a problem with that sonically. So it's interesting. So, but yeah, we had sort of specific groups that were doing that.
That's got to be the most incredibly fun sort of assignment, where it's almost like, you know, Wes Anderson creating a fictional Europe. Like you're devising this entire alternate universe of English pop.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. It is.
Do you dig through your record collection when you're doing that, or do you have it in your head? Or,
well, I mean, you know, I think that it's sort of one of the fun things about it is to be able to interact with people like Lee Ronaldo and these people who are really steeped in it, who can bring something to it as well. So, I mean, I've relied on the kindness of strangers, in the sense that, you know, I'm certainly open to input from all these musicians who might have an idea or a song or a riff or, you know, something to go with. So, I mean, that again is another sort of level of collaboration, which is sort of what's really fun about making movies, is that it really is, you know, you're not alone, you know.
Was there anything that wasn't used that went into the reject pile? And
yeah, I mean, we probably had some extra songs that we did. Yeah, there are probably a couple things. I think I remember that we did a couple songs by this group called The Pretty Things. And one of the great things, I guess, about in terms of remembering Velvet Goldmine was that Ron Ashton from The Stooges, we brought him to New York to play with us. And that was, again, it was fun because we were, you know, we were creating something new, but we were also touching some of the original Grease, you know.
Do you ever get starstruck now?
Only tonight, Matt.
Next clip.
Yeah.
Actually, the David Bowie. Speaking of David Bowie, you did get to work with David Bowie's music just a few years later.
Yeah, we. You know, I think maybe it's because when David Bowie said no to us for Velvet Goldmine, I kind of saw that as, in a way, as good news. But then, you know, the David Bowie camp was very helpful when we were making Life Aquatic, where we basically turned David Bowie's music into bossa nova.
And we have an example of that, and let's show that. I'll never turn down a chance to show a clip from this movie.
Let's go to my island. I have to be back in Kentucky on Thursday.
Thursday.
Okay. That's okay.
Você não sabe se vai ou vem, ou como importa se o dinheiro é seu. Ei, vem, se é legal, passe amanhã, pegue o que é seu. A maquiagem vai desmanchar, para o seu medo aparecer. 0-0, agora eu vou.
You've got an entire, not an entire Bowie soundtrack, but it's Bowie heavy.
Yeah. Well, we did, there are two records that we did for Life Aquatic. We actually have the Sao George Rome sessions that were released separately, so that's a total Bowie thing. And I mean, all of this, conceptually, I've told the story before, really the only, I used to, during Life Aquatic, Wes and I would meet on Sundays and I would read the new pages as he was writing them week by week. And one Sunday there was a line in the script that said, Pele comes on deck and sings the David Bowie song in Portuguese. And that was it. And that was it. And then we found South George, and really the miracle of it is just that he is a musical genius, and he brought it to the process. I mean, he really was not very familiar with David Bowie songs. And over the course of like 3 or 4 recording sessions in Rome, he captured this flavor that, you know, I mean, people love it. I mean, and we loved it. And really what would happen was that sort of at every location, at the end of the day, Wes would call up George and say, okay, let's do another one. And that's how it happened.
He liked him so much that he gives him the exit. He plays over the closing credits.
Yeah. So, I love that movie and the spirit of David Bowie. We got great feedback from David Bowie about the music that we used, and they were very gracious and very open to letting us do what we wanted to do.
So this is a case where this idea of having him is almost like the bard of the movie is something that happens organically as a result of listening to him.
Yeah, I mean, it just was so wonderful, you know, and he transformed it, and it became his character, his sound, and the voice of the movie.
Okay, so we have one more here, and we're going to talk about it beforehand because it's our last clip, and then we'll take some questions. We'll take some questions after the clip. Now, as a matter of fact, we won't. We're not going to listen to this one because it's just black screen.
I think we can let this one go, Matt.
I think we can. All right, let's take some questions. Can I... see, maybe I'll.
Hi, Randy. I was wondering if you could talk a little more about the music in Wolf of Wall Street, because I found it really interesting how it was set in the 90s, but you had quite a few blues songs in there. Like, I remember Elmore James,
right.
Howlin' Wolf. So where did the inspiration for that come?
I think that's Marty, really.
Yeah.
I think that. That's really sort of the rebel spirit really peeking through, and I think that, you know, Bo Diddley and these are things that I think are I think that they are emblematic of sort of the individual trying to break out and the unique individual spirit. Marty is, again, you know, he's, you know, it's funny is that the other on-camera sequence in the film was that we had this wedding band playing, and it was Sharon Jones and the Dap Kings, and we recorded a bunch of songs with them, Marty is just so bold, and since all of a sudden it goes into Bo Diddley while we're watching a band play another song, and it's just sort of like, there just are no rules, really, where he makes his own rules, or he's just so committed to his own satisfaction, I guess.
Does he carry all of this around in his head? I mean, does he say, do you know that song? Can we throw that on?
Yeah,
or?
I mean, I think there's certain things that Marty does. There's certain things that happen with Marty in the privacy of his own home, and then I think there are things where he and I have more of a dialogue about. But I would say, with Marty is that he really makes certain decisions that allow him, and I think there are other directors or directors who are sort of finding their footing, is that, you know, Marty makes a decision which then allows him to detail it in terms of how to edit to a song. And, you know, sometimes you find directors like, you know, the worst thing I always hear is like, oh, I love that song. Can I hear 5 more like that song? Mm-hmm. Or, oh, you know, they can't commit to it. And where Marty, like, he commits, and that allows him to choreograph in a way that decisiveness affords him that ability.
Another one. Way in the back there.
I'm going to talk about your involvement.
Oh, wait a second. Let's wait for the mic.
I'm going to bring you a microphone.
Okay.
Here you go.
Could you talk about your involvement in Kids and working on that?
Kids, I somebody sent me a script, and it said, "Kids, by the world famous writer Harmony Korine," and it cracked me up, and I just like, who is this person?
He was like 19 or something,
yeah.
Right?
And then Harmony and I sort of became, we sort of established a dialogue and traded music back and forth, and Harmony really was, I mean, sometimes I forget, or people forget, that Harmony did not direct Kids, but Harmony was certainly creatively at many points was the driving force and credible source. And then really, Harmony wanted to suggest that we work with a guy named Lou Barlow, who had a rock band in Boston called Sebado, and I went up there and worked with Lou and with a guy he was working with named John Davis, and we sort of, out of that was born Folk Implosion, and we sort of built that out, and the crazy thing is we made that song Natural One out of the score piece that became like a top 40 hit. And then again, we have a variety of other things that are in there that sort of gave it some contour, and worked with Daniel Johnson and did an original song with Daniel Johnson. But I think it was really the Folk Implosion sound that was really so original and unique to that film.
How often is it that music ends up in a film that is not suggested by somebody at the top level, like a director or producer? Does that ever happen?
Yeah, I mean, so things end up in movies in all different ways, really. A lot of times an editor can play something that either is the idea itself or is the wellspring of the idea, or an actor brings something to it. I mean, so again, like I said, to the point of like my picking, you know, it's you just sort of have to be open to where it's going and be open to suggestion.
Right. Another one, right here. Wait for the mic.
Hello. You open and close Moonrise Kingdom with Britain, and you use them a lot throughout the film.
Right.
Could you talk a little bit about that and why Britain kind of sets the tone?
Well, that was something, the Noah's Flood was, Wes had been in a production of Noah's Flood as a kid, and that was a piece of music that even before Moonrise Kingdom existed on any level, that was something that Wes had played, said, I'm thinking I want to do something with this. And then, in terms of our process, really the way it goes is like all of a sudden Wes, we find this sort of anchor, or this foundation, and then it's sort of on me to gather every piece of Benjamin Britten or anything that might be related. And then I would say it's really, we kind of have it, it's part of our process of saying, let's try to use as much of it as we can. And so that's really how it sort of grows from there.
One more? Way in the back there.
So what plays in your kitchen on Sunday morning when you're making eggs? What's your downtime music?
It depends on who I'm cooking breakfast for,
You're cooking breakfast for Madeleine Albright. Go.
Madeleine Albright is a crazy Iggy Azalea freak. I listen to the radio a lot, so whether it's Kiss FM or whatever else it is, I do my best to sort of stay current on all sorts of levels. And thankfully, I think I still feel like I am a music lover, as I always have been, so I can still sort of keep my civilian ears on.
So you don't go through phases where you feel like you're always working?
I am always working.
Yeah, so you hear music and you're thinking, can I use this, and if so, where?
Yeah, I mean, it has, but I enjoy it. I enjoy just listening to it, and it doesn't always have to be so masterminded.
Can you talk just a little bit about this idea of the vault, which we talked about backstage?
Well, it's just in terms of like with Wes particularly, there's certain pieces of music that we have kept away for, you know, the right cinematic moment. You know, I was telling you that most notably there was Bobby Fuller's Let Her Dance, which we had put away, and then we found the moment at the end of Fantastic Mr. Fox where there was Le Temps de l'Amour. Remember that one? I don't know if you guys know the
Jerry Gilman is here.
Yeah. So he got the dance to it. You know, that was a piece that Wes and I came upon. We were working on a commercial and we put that one away. So, and there's some things. So, that's the vault.
All right. So thank you very much for coming out, and we're going to sign some books now, and I think Randall might be amenable to talking about music a little more. I don't know.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.